IVM.
The Rotormouth podcast is an IVM production, and if you enjoyed this episode, you can also check out the other awesome shows like Geek Fruit with fellow and television geeks Tejas, Jishnu and Dinkar, where they discuss the world of science fiction and nerd culture. Hi, this is Sanjeev. Welcome to the Rotormouth podcast. Today we have a very, very interesting guest, a good friend of mine who basically travels the world, comes to India when he feels like, basically drives cars all over the place and tells me while we were coming here that driving in India is horrible, which I agree with. So that's why we took a cab and we came here. Hi, I would like to introduce him. Please go ahead and introduce yourself first.
Hi, everyone. My name is Rehan. I am a marketing, branding and communications consultant. Work in the luxury and lifestyle industry per se. And I'm also a fine jewelry designer. I started this business last year. And so far, it's been good. And yes, I have a passion for cars, food, anything fast.
Okay.
I enjoy my moments of silence.
Okay.
Photography.
Okay.
Travel, like Sanjeev already mentioned, been traveling quite a bit thanks to my work. And yeah, thanks to that, I get to, you know, explore parts of the country, parts of the city, either by car or by any other means of public transport or friends or family.
Fantastic. See, silence you're not going to get here. You'll get everything else. Silence if we get, then our, you know, listeners
Absolutely.
Will run away. So tell me, Rehan, as we were discussing, your first thing is when we talk about driving abroad, as you were telling me the other day, you've driven all sorts of vehicles.
That's
you've
right.
You've enjoyed it. And so any favorites that stand out? What is it that you like about driving in LA?
Well, basically, everything is more organized. I think everybody understands, has got a lot of civic sense and other, driving sense. I mean, yes, there's always going to be, you know, the one or two bad apples that are there in every basket. But per se, overall, I think it's more organized. People, you know, have a little bit patient. You know, they drive, they spend a lot of their times in their cars, hours in their cars. So, you know, they are more patient. They drive as per the rules. They understand that someone does want to get over from, you know, change the lane suddenly, and they respect that. And, you know, there's a gesture by saying thank you, by, you know, waving your hand out of your car, saying thank you very much. And so it's pretty much more civilized, I should say.
Okay.
Over here, it's like the Wild West, you know, where suddenly you're put your car in first gear, and the next thing you know is you're swiped in front by either a person talking on his phone or somebody on a bike. So, and then you're the one that gets shouted upon for not driving well.
And then you have hand gestures.
Exactly.
So, all sorts of weird hand gestures.
Exactly. So the moral of the story is, after all these years of driving, I've decided public transport is the best means of mode of commute in Bombay. So you have your lovely local trains and your private your kadi pilis, and obviously the, you know, the cab sharing. So I think that's fair enough to say.
Oh, fantastic. Okay, so you know what you were telling me, we were talking of SUVs, and today coincidentally the Lamborghini Urus is launching.
That's right.
Yes, so you've had a look at it, I think, abroad?
No, I haven't. I haven't seen that, but I have seen the Levante, I've seen the F-Pace. And I have to say, I was very impressed with the Levante, the Maserati. I mean, it looks like the Maserati per se is one of my favorite vehicles. Probably, if I were to do a top five,
okay,
I'd definitely, a Maserati would be in there.
Okay, so do the top five. Tell us, what is your top five?
The Range Rover.
Okay.
The Maserati.
Okay.
The Quattroporte.
Okay.
I would have the Ferrari F430.
Okay.
The Aston Martin and the Vantage.
Okay.
And surprisingly, it's a Lexus. I would use the Tesla, not even the Lexus, the Tesla, the D90, the SUV.
Okay, you've driven the Tesla D90.
Yes, I did. And it was, I must tell you, it was an experience.
Please tell us. It's not every day that we get people who've driven this.
So it's a piece of art, actually, and a piece of engineering. Hats off to Musk and his whole team back at Tesla for creating a vehicle. So basically, there is no sound in the car, because generally when you turn on the ignition, it's, you hear the engine rev. But in this case, it just starts up and it's quiet inside the cabin. There's this gorgeous screen right in front of you that handles everything, right from opening the doors to getting all the updates to live music streaming channels, if you want to hear the news, whatever. And wow, what can I say? I mean, I tested the autonomous pilot, the autopilot on the car and on the LA freeway, and I was amazed. I think India would be better off with driverless cars than with cars having drivers.
Okay, fantastic. So, but this thing when you drove the autonomous, what kind of distances did you drive?
See, basically in LA, because there is so much of traffic and so many people use their cars to get to work, you know, starting and stopping, well, they don't use stick shift anyways. Most of the cars are, I mean, automatic, but nonetheless, so you don't have to do anything. It's basically the car decides when to start, when to stop, what speed to go. It's unbelievable. It's actually quite a remarkable thing to be sitting in that vehicle, and it's got power. It's not, I mean, if you want to step on it, really, it takes off. It's fast. Let me tell you, it is really fast.
So what I understand is basically now this is autonomous means in the sense that it's completely autonomous, where you're just sitting in the car. It's been programmed.
Yeah.
And this is now happening across LA, or is it happening in only certain areas?
Well, ever, I mean, I just wanted to test the power feature, so I did it. I mean, I'm sure people would do it. It's very practical in traffic, because then, you know, your hands are free and you don't have to worry about control driving the car, or, you know, controlling the steerings and stuff. Yeah, obviously, on a turn, you do require a little bit of guidance on the steering to turn it. So, but other than that, I think it's fantastic.
Fantastic. Okay, so this is basically unique, because that means this is far more advanced than what we are reading back here.
Yeah, I mean, they are going to be launching the Model S. I think they are delayed in their production for some reason. It was just out, I think. But I feel they will have some of, I mean, it's not going to have all the features of the 90 and the other sedan, the Tesla sedan. But I think the basic stuff that drives both all across the Tesla vehicles will be there. So, I mean, I would, if you're spending money on a BMW 3 Series, I'd rather buy that. I'd buy the Tesla Model S.
So next time we visit you in LA, you'll be driving a Tesla.
Hopefully.
So as we were talking also, America is SUV territory.
That's right.
It's where all the SUVs are fighting for space.
That's right.
And I think you also have all your favorites. You've named a lot of SUVs in your favorites.
Yep.
So you were driving, I believe you told me you're driving a Range Rover, right?
Yep, the Range Rover 4.2 liter V8 HSE. And it's, I mean, I don't have words to describe it. It is that beautiful a drive, be it on-road or off-road.
Okay.
It really doesn't matter. It takes both of them with equal amount of ease. There is a lot of power. The handling is fantastic. I mean, it's the complete package. So once you drive a Range Rover and you drive any other SUV, you will see the difference. I mean, there is no comparison.
So for you, the SUV starts and ends with the Range Rover?
Absolutely, absolutely.
So you drove a lot with that in?
Yes, I did. In fact, the other SUVs, I mean, even from the, I've driven the X5, the Hummer, the ML350, the Cadillac Escalade, then the Honda Pilot, I've driven the Nissan Murano, the Infiniti Q35 or Q40. The GMC Tahoe, the Yukon, the 4Runner. So, yeah, I've driven quite a few.
Yes, we can get that. Yeah. We can figure that out. And on that note, I think we'll come back from a break, because I still have to recover from all the names of the cars that he's given. So we'll see you after the break.
Long, long ago, not in Bethlehem, but in a place nearby, there was a wonderful birth of a huge show, which I like to call Cyrus Says, a show that encapsulates everything in human history. From the first Homo sapien to the last Homo sapien, who's traversed the entire world and then come back to India. This is a show which tells you everything about everything. If you want to know, avoid Google, come to us. It's called Cyrus Says. Get new episodes every Monday on the IVM podcast app or wherever you get your podcast on. You get one banana water free with every podcast. Right. I'll just check that.
Welcome back. Okay, Rehan, I'm still recovering from the SUV overload. So now we will talk about performance cars, and LA is home of the drifting series.
That's right.
I don't know if it's official or unofficial.
Oh, no, it's not. It's unofficial.
So have you visited any of those kind of places?
No, I haven't, but it's on my list. In fact, there is another huge drag racing festival that happens in the Nevada desert every year. And it's a big thing, and you'll see all your fancy cars and speed rockets.
Okay.
you know, just out there for the day, and it's crazy. But yes, I mean, you have, if you've seen Fast and the Furious, you'll see a lot of the those cars that you've seen in the movie actually are in LA, and a lot of there's a huge market for performance cars and performance parts. Not only in LA, but globally as well.
Okay, fantastic. So you, performance cars are equally on your list. You enjoy driving those as well?
I have never driven one, to be honest with you. But yeah, if the opportunity comes in, I would definitely look at it.
Okay. And are you a motorcycle guy or mainly cars?
No, both actually. Equally both. I haven't ridden a motorcycle in a long time, but that's hopefully that will change in the next few
Why
weeks.
Is that?
Well, it's... I don't own a bike over here, to be honest with you.
No, I think you've made that clear. You don't want anything here.
No, I mean, still a two. It's funny that you bring this up, because I was in Europe a couple of weeks back, and in Paris, if you see the population of two wheelers, it's unbelievable. And I'm not talking about your, obviously, I'm not talking about the, you know, the 100 cc's. I'm talking about more the 400, 500, including a three wheeler scooter, like your, you know, you have your Kinetic and your Activa. So Peugeot has a three wheeler, which has got two wheels in the front and one wheel at the back. And it's so comfortable that it gives you the opportunity in the accessories part of it. When it rains, you can actually cover your lap, you know.
With wow.
So those are the, it's thought of. It's very well thought of. It's not just, you know, you want something to put it out there. No, it's 800cc bike, but it's absolutely stunning. Automatic. So, yeah, I think there is a lot of, for cities like Mumbai or Delhi where there's too much of traffic, I think two-wheeler makes a lot of sense.
Okay. But so, would you ride one in?
Yeah, I would. I would.
You would. We're going to hold you on to it. Next time we're going to do a podcast with you riding a bike.
Yeah.
And I'll be recording live.
Perfect. Sounds good. I'll get my friend's Ducati Monster ready. He's traveling right now. So
okay.
We shall go for a
Shravan is also planning to cover this. I'm sorry. I shouldn't say names, but yes.
Shravan's most welcome.
Yes. And the bike that you saw down below, it's his.
Okay.
So you can ask him how the bike is.
Okay.
At later on after the show. Okay. So this place is interesting. You are you want to ride bikes in Europe. You travel. The way you travel, what do you see? How do you see transportation changing in the world now when you're traveling? You think we are up there or we are still far behind?
I think we are way far behind, and we are very regressive that way.
Okay.
The reason I say regressive is the fact that any developing nation, or actually India, shouldn't be amongst known. Shouldn't be called as a developing nation, but above the developing and a little below the developed part of
okay,
it.
Okay, okay.
And we should be embracing technologies like hybrid cars, like electric vehicles, and we should be pioneering that.
Okay.
Rather than saying that, oh, we are developing, so, you know, we need all that. I'm sorry, that's a very regressive way of thinking. And then you're being a hypocrite and saying the other side, yes, we want to save the planet. So how can you, you know, how can you do that? So I think, and look at the government's stance. I mean, for a hybrid, a Toyota Prius hybrid, which in the U.S. Costs, I think, about anywhere between $25,000 to $30,000, which is about, 20 lakhs at the current market. You're pricing that vehicle at 50 lakhs. I mean, who's going to buy it, and you want to promote clean, clean energy and clean vehicles? It's not going to work. So unless and until you don't put very stringent laws and, regulations in place, and especially favoring electric vehicles. And I mean, I'm sure there are a lot of, kids in India from different education backgrounds and schools who are exploring the possibility of coming up with their own electric vehicles for this country, rather than having it, you know, imported. Because I mean, I saw some time back on a very briefly that Celerio had this whole autonomous vehicle. But yeah. I mean, that's just, I mean, are they really thinking about going into production? I mean, you still have your hybrids, but how good are they? I mean, why aren't there any more, charging stations? I mean, the government has, I read somewhere that they're going to be about two or three of them, one in Bombay or one in Delhi.
Yeah, no, you know, that's exactly a question.
So unless, it's like you don't have the infrastructure to hold anything, and then you want to bring in a whole bunch of things. First, get the, it's like, it's the problem with India, cart before the horse.
Yeah. That's true.
So that needs to change, I think.
No, I agree with you, because we've touched on this in a previous episode where we've said that it all sounds great that India is going to go electric by 2030. But we don't have the infrastructure for charging stations. We don't have the infrastructure for the batteries.
Exactly.
So there has to be a well thought out plan. The smart cities that are supposed to come up should be mirroring that. But what I don't understand right now is we are saying that's all great. If all the population is going to start shifting to the smart cities, that's fantastic. But those cities are going to come as satellite towns. And as we have seen in Bombay, when Vashi and places like that started developing, you've not seen the population exodus happening there. It's a transfer. There are a lot of new age people go there. So my point is, even in the existing cities, you should have enough infrastructure for charging stations.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's very key. And just to bring out your point, I think when Vashi and New Bombay was created was back in the day when we didn't have access to so many things that we have today.
Absolutely.
Okay, because and since you talk about smart, I mean, you look at the internet speed. We talk about 4 Mbps and 5 and 20 Mbps. I mean, there is no bandwidth with any of these companies to provide you with 20 Mbps. You would probably get 4 Mbps if you're in any of those service providers' showroom, because they need to show that this is the strength. But other than that, to have smart cities, you need to have seamless high-speed internet that keeps on, because that's the thing, IoT, that's what it's going to be, Internet of Things. To accomplish that, you need to have that kind of infrastructure that supports the high-speed data transfer. And to do that, you need to have bandwidth, which we don't. So how are you expecting everything to run on, you're calling smart cities, but you cannot provide a simple high-speed connection for more than 2 minutes.
Absolutely. So what this also reflects is that if you're talking of transportation and roads improving, everything around the roads also has to improve.
Absolutely.
You need more petrol stations, you need more rest stops, you need more restaurants, you need to do all of that.
And I think with the smart cities, it should even be more with the autonomous vehicles, so that within the smart city, transport should be absolutely autonomous. So, because it's all within a sort of demarcated zone. It's between like a 5 square kilometer or 2 or 3 or whatever the smart city is. So within that, your transport should be fully autonomous. Everything should be as self-sustaining as possible, which means using wind energy or sun energy to power your smart cities, not relying on the government to give you your basic amenities like electricity, water, but rather use whatever the nature has given you. And that's the whole idea of being smart, right? That you don't depend on anybody else, but everything what is there with you. So I think those things need to come in place. It's not, we have all the talent, we have everybody, but it's just, at the end of the day, the guys who are wanting to do it are just heartbroken because of the red tape and the bureaucracy that happens in the government. So basically nothing has changed over the last 60 years. There is still the same bureaucracy that is happening, and it'll continue to happen. So, I mean, I don't see the smart cities coming up in my generation, but probably in another 2 generations. They'll probably put a blueprint together. It's the same thing like what happened to the ceiling. The ceiling talk started in 1988 and it finally got built in 2008. So it took 20 years to get 5 kilometers done on sea. So we're talking about smart cities.
So we have basically been touched upon, we've touched upon performance cars. No, but I'm saying, okay, now I get what you're saying. And of course, as you started off with this gusto about SUVs, what happens if we get smart cities and all that? What happens to the SUVs, the performance SUVs that you want to drive?
Well, you see, again, there is a solution for this. It's like you have to be smart. Again, you're talking about smart. Create tracks. I mean, charge people. If you have your performance cars and you want to go out and enjoy and completely drive and, make the most of your cars, create circuits. There's so much of space available outside of in Lonavala between the Bombay Pune highway or Bombay or anywhere, and charge them 1,000 rupees a day. People who can afford to have Lamborghinis and Ferraris wouldn't mind paying 1,000 rupees a day just to go and get enjoy themselves and get the most out of their car. So these are the kind of things that you need to do. So it's, you're giving employment to people. The money that you're collecting already pays for the you know, all the restoration
and infrastructure.
So it pays for itself. Let it be private. Why does the government have to be involved in everything?
I agree with you. So, Rehan, you know, this has been like fascinating. It's a fantastic episode that has gone through so far.
Thank you.
I think these minutes have just flown by, and you have given us insights about driving abroad. What are the things you've done? You've sat in an autonomous car, which I don't know how many people in India have done so far. We are just dreaming about it. And this has been fantastic, and I would love to have you on the show more and more whenever you're down
likewise,
in India.
Likewise. It was. Thank you, Sanjeev, for having me over, and I would love to be there. And next time we shall talk about my road trip from New York State to New Mexico.
Oh, fantastic. No, we can talk about it now. Do you want to talk about it now?
Oh, yeah, it was great. 27-hour journey.
Yeah.
You know, 3 days. It took 2 days, actually. 2.5 days.
Okay.
And so it was just basically great passing through Pennsylvania, Ohio, Indiana.
Okay.
Missouri, Texas, and then into New Mexico. So it was absolutely, I mean, I actually got to see the farmland of Indiana, of Missouri, Texas.
Okay.
You're talking about when you come into Texas, you see cattle everywhere, which is Texas also happens to be the beef capital of the world. So,
okay.
You know, but yeah, it was a great drive because you're driving at about 100, 140, depending on which
what
state.
What car were you driving?
I was driving an SUV. I was driving a Honda CR-V, all-wheel drive.
Okay.
And a colleague of mine and I, we both had driven. So it was great. I experienced a first hand road trip and drove back in the week. So 3,400 miles in a week, and it was great.
Fantastic. Okay, Rehan, so second time around, I am thanking you.
My pleasure.
Yeah, because we were going to end on the previous note, but now then you suddenly said you have a road trip on the way.
Yeah.
So I said, oh, fantastic. Let's talk about it. So it sounds fantastic, and we shall see you very soon.
Thank you,
and
Sanjeev.
Hope you had a great time on the show.
Thank you very much for having me over, and look forward to seeing you again.
Before we let you go, we would want to know where we can follow you, where can one get in touch with you?
Okay, so I am on Instagram. You can follow me on at Reshaikh, R-E-S-H-A-I-K-H 2003. I am on Twitter, but it's mostly purely football-based, but it's the same handle at Reshaikh. So these two are my accounts.
Do you have a website? Is there anything else? Maybe?
Yep, you can. I'm on Facebook. On my Facebook, you can look me up at Rehan Shaikh. And if you want to look at my work in jewelry on Facebook, it is at Atelier Rehan. And on Instagram, it's the same thing at Atelier Rehan.
Fantastic. And you can follow us on Facebook at Rotormouthing. Twitter on Rotormouthing. Instagram is the same. And we are also on the, we have a website live now. So it's www.rotormouth.com. And also please follow IBM on social media and the various social media handles that they have on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Also on the website. And they have an app on the iOS as well as the Google's Play Store.
There she stands, a podcast addict. Outside the bank, having traveled several miles to get in with other poor souls like her. The journey, though daunting for this youngling, will have some comfort because she has downloaded her favorite podcast. You can see more of her species on ivmpodcasts.com, your one-stop destination where you can check out the coolest Indian podcasts. Happy listening.